He is me. Mio fratello.
Bra.
Marco Sermarini started the Italian Chesterton Society. He's the president of the Italian Chesterton Society. He started a school, a classical Catholic school named for G.K. Chesterton.
Oh, wow.
The same year that I started Chesterton Academy, without either of us knowing that the other person even existed.
It's true.
We both married women from Italy. Not so strange in his case. But here's where it gets amazing. Our wives were born in the same town. Chesterton says that coincidences are spiritual puns. And this, Marco and I continue to just be amazed at how we think alike and just have the same approach to everything. And the only difference is, I am better looking than he is.
I disagree. Okay.
What did I say? That I must be better looking than
you? The last one.
Okay. Yeah, then you are better looking. Yes, right. The other difference is that I talk with my hands and he does not. I had the great privilege of visiting Marco in Italy on three different occasions, and we visited San Benedetto del Tronto, where he is from, and where he runs the school. It's a beautiful coastal town on the Adriatic coast, and he is running an amazing operation there. He'll tell you about it, but please give a very warm welcome to Marco Sermarini.
Say every some line I will insert some Italian word, not because only because I am talking about Chesterton and Italy and many other things, so, but because a good friend of mine, last year conference speaker, Father Spencer Howe, a great speaker, a great friend of mine, was saying to me, please Marco, every some line, insert some Italian word. So, for free. Without any reason. Why? Because people coming at the conferences are just like people going at the zoo. They want to hear the voice of the animal. So, every some line, you will hear the voice of the elephant, or the rhino, I don't know the voice of the rhino. Anyway, or the lion, and something else. So, completely for free, okay? Without paying bills, just like Dale, grande. Okay. Let's go al sodo, as we Italians say. Andiamo al sodo, at the hard thing, at the tough thing, okay? Dear American friends, first of all, have mercy on me and on my shameless English. It's shameless, absolutely. I can't do any more. Don't say anything. Okay, I'm very happy to be here with you all and very grateful for the invitation, because I can give back what Dale gave us last year in Italy for our annual Chesterton Day. We celebrate the Chesterton Day since 2004, more or less. I'm grateful for the warm friendship that some one of you served for me and my Italian fellows, and for our Scuola Chesterton, that is, it is the twin school. Everything was true, what they said. We didn't know each other, and we started the school from the same points, from the same quotation of G.K. Chesterton. After, I will read it. I hope you will enjoy the speech and you will find some more reason to love this great man, G.K. Chesterton, so important for my life. Anyway, I have to acknowledge to my good friend, Father Spencer Howe, the value of many things that I will say. He's the author of a brilliant and invaluable dissertation for his license in Sacred Theology on Chesterton and Italy. I gave him some news and traces to follow about our hero and Italy. And he digged a lot and found several treasures. But above all, he gave the honor of history to many scattered things that could be forgotten. Grazie, Spencer. You did a lot for it. It's written with pencil. You did a lot for Italian Chestertonians, and I'm very grateful. I'm so grateful, more of all, to our Lord for the gift of Chesterton, a true, irreplaceable good friend for me. Believe me, if I say good friend, I say a true thing. I'm not saying something sentimental. I'm very grateful to him. How many good gifts he gave me. First, I would like to start from this Chesterton's expression, Italy, a nation of gentlemen. Because it is one more proof of Chesterton genius. And Chesterton's wit. In recognizing the particular genius lying in every people. And also because I'm very proud of it. Even if the paradise of thieves, Father Brown's story, is located in Italy. Anyway, go on. Chesterton in Italy is surely strange, but sincere and deep and full of affection, relationship, indeed. I'm here to bear witness to it. The main reason of this love for Italy lays in the fact that Rome is in Italy. Not only the town, the idea of Rome and all that Rome means is the reason for this love. Italy is an important place for many reasons. We could take the same words of St. Paul in the Acts of the Apostles. Dic mi si tu, Romanus es, at ille dixit etiam. Tell me, art thou a Roman? But he said, yeah. G.K. Chesterton could say the same thing. There is no doubt. And then, like magic, we will pass from Italy to the whole world. Because we are talking about the universal Chesterton. And that is possible to do also for you. And worth doing it. G.K. Chesterton opens up many windows to every one of us. And then can open also a door to go and browse the world and love all that God made for us. Okay. Italy and Chesterton, a fertile relationship. We can start from his trips in Italy. I think they are quite significant in a certain sense. He came in Italy 6 times. In 1894 with his father, Mr. Red, during Easter period. This is the time when he wrote to a friend, Edmund Clerio Bentley, many letters from Italy. In 1919, with his wife Frances, on the road to Holy Land. It was a very brief stay. In 1920, back from Holy Land, always with his wife. It was a longer period with a deep experience of the approaching conversion to Catholicism and the promise and the commitment to convert that he took in a church in Brindisi, southern Italy. In 1929, for St. Thomas More, when he stayed at Hotel Hassler near Spanish Steps, or as we Italians say, Trinità dei Monti. That hotel where once someone found him in the hall, calmed by a mob of lively children, enjoying this combing. It was a 3 month period. This is the time when he met Pope Pius XI and Benito Mussolini. In 1934, for recovering from an illness in March, May, he went to Rome, Naples, Sicily, and Malta. Not Italy, but half Arabian, half Italian. In 1935, just like us. 1935, for the so-called Maggio Fiorentino, the May of Florence. He arrived in May after being in Spain and France. He visited Liguria and Rapallo, and there he met Max Birbon and Ezra Pound, then Pisa and Florence, where he gave the lecture La letteratura inglese e la tradizione latina, that is English literature and the Latin tradition, on May 14th. In Chesterton's times, Italy was a nation longing for a spiritual revival, and the English Catholic literary revival was a great occasion. Italy came out by the unity period, which was a very harsh one for Catholic Church, and Chesterton was a great amount of fresh air for us. Chesterton and Belloc were a wonderful literary and spiritual news for Italy, and there were great men waiting for it. I have to mention particularly Emilio Cecchi and Father Giuseppe De Luca, and the reviews that they were driving, La Ronda and Il Frontespizio. I'll tell you more on. Particularly, I have to say that Emilio Cecchi was the so-called mentore italiano di Chesterton, the Italian mentor of G.K. Chesterton. First steps. Chesterton was first read by some intellectual figures in his own language. I found some weeks ago a brief letter of July 1910 from Alessandro Casati, politician, Italian minister after the World War II, to Giuseppe Prezzolini, great journalist, writer, editor for La Ronda, La Voce, close friend of that Emilio Cecchi, so important for us, and Giovanni Papini, another Italian admirer, convert. Quoting, "What's wrong with the world?" The chapter "Wanted an Unpractical Man" that he got, Alessandro Casati got, from an article of Mario Borsa, another Italian journalist living in England and correspondent for the Times. This is the evidence of a growing and spreading interest for GKC during those first years and before his arrival as an appreciated journalist in 1919, 1920 and on in Italy. Emilio Cecchi wrote about G.K. Chesterton in 1910 an article named Verità in Paradossi, Truth in Paradoxes. And then in 1913 a review of The Man Who Was Thursday's French translation of 1913. And an article named L'Apostolo Giocondo, The Merry Apostle. The first Chesterton's works editions in Italy were Letters to an Old Garibaldian, The Barbarism of Berlin, that were propaganda writings. Then Man Alive. Two of them, as we said, were propaganda writings, but as you could see, there was already an interest towards him. The following years, we had many translations, starting with Orthodoxy, The Man Who Was Thursday, The Innocence of Father Brown and the Other Father Browns, The Ball and the Cross, The Club of the Quick Trades, The Napoleon of Notting Hill, and on and on. The growing interest for those Englishmen forced Emilio Cecchi to go to Bakersfield to meet G.K. Chesterton in November 1919. It is a wonderful account of what he saw. I think these are the most beautiful words about G.K. Chesterton that I ever heard. Emilio Cecchi is indeed Chesterton's mentor Italiano, as we said, no doubt. Father Spencer lectured last year, and so I don't go on talking about Emilio Cecchi so deep. Anyway, I have to say the best Italian pages about G.K. Chesterton were written by Cecchi. As Father Howe says, he understood Chesterton in himself and not just his writings to be paradoxical. He's the most important witness of the relationship between GKC and Italy. I think one quotation from his article about the visit at Beaconfield is very significant. Me l'aspettavo tranquillo sulla mole del lavoro compiuto. I stopped the quotation in Italian. I read you my, I hope, good translation. I expected he would be quiet on the amount of work accomplished. And he was merry of flashing certainties, but also full of problems and difficulties, all taken, held, thrust with his vast moral stature in the difficulty of this world. Emilio Cecchi and the Rondisti, the member of the review that was La Ronda, perhaps the main factor, La Ronda was the main factor for Chesterton's reception in Italy, were seeking to foster a literary revival also in Italy, to oppose and counter the futurist movement. Emilio Cecchi introduced officially Chesterton and Belloc to the Italian readers in a piece on La Ronda titled Ospiti, it means guests. But about G.K. Chesterton, he says, I still wrote times and times, so that at the end, it seems it should have been considered almost a hangout for me. Since many years at this point, we felt interested in these two writers, Belloc and Chesterton, for many attitudes of their own style and of their own politics, for their stubbornness as men of faith, and their great skill as jokers and humorists. Finally, for that steady filial insight towards Rome. On their behalf, they didn't want to consider too immature or any way inappropriate our company. And so, here they are in our review. There is a number of letters between from and to Cecchi and Chesterton and Belloc, several times with the help of Francis. This is a witness of the intensity of this relationship. Cecchi decided to publish serially Man Alive on La Ronda with the title Le Avventure di un Uomo Vivo. That sounds The Adventures of a Man Alive, of an Alive Man. Okay. This is the title that I prefer because the adventure is so important in G.K. Chesterton. This was the first work ever translated in Italian after the two propaganda writings. Anyway, Emilio Cecchi says, è uno dei più brillanti racconti o romanzi metafisico-polizieschi. It's one of the most brilliant tales, or metaphysical detective stories, if you prefer, of this furious writer. Why do I speak about French editions? Because G.K. Chesterton arrived first in Italy by French editions, also by his maternal language, but the French editions were so important. There was a great relation, cultural relation between France and Italy in that time, and men like Emilio Cecchi wanted to open another door towards England. Some of the things in French were reviewed by an extraordinary reviewer, Monsignor Giovanni Battista Montini, that is Paul VI. He wrote two reviews, one on orthodoxy and the other one on Menelaus. Another important bridgehead to the landing of Chesterton in Italy was Father Giuseppe De Luca. Father Giuseppe De Luca was a very brilliant priest, very great scholar. This man was a far-looking one. He understood the importance of English Catholic literary revival, and he wanted to exploit the strength of these ideas, the ideas of G.K. Chesterton and Bella, to start a renewal of spiritual and literary life in Italy. So he asked them to write articles for Il Frontespizio, his literary review. There is a point that another professor and journalist made, Nicoletta Neri. Nicoletta Neri wrote an interesting essay on G.K. Chesterton 2 weeks after his death. She was an Italian professor of literature and translator of G.K. Chesterton. She understood one of the aspects that perhaps contributed to his gradual decline of popularity in Italy, but I say not only in Italy. He did not approve the world as it was, but sought to change it by changing minds and hearts. That is what we are doing now. He was a polemical writer through and through, and Nicoletta says, the main Chesterton's relationship with his time was of disapproval and of protest, and he assumed in today's England the role of the anti-modern. There are many other scholars that were very interested in G.K. Chesterton, for example, Mario Prats, that was a great Englishist, and Decio Pettoello, who had correspondence, many letters with G.K. Chesterton, and many others. He had also strange admirers. One was Benito Mussolini. Yes, he read some books of G.K. Chesterton. They had a meeting, and G.K. Chesterton wanted to interview Mussolini, but the end was that Mussolini interviewed G.K. Chesterton, as was a journalist before being the Prime Minister of Italy. And another strange admirer was Antonio Gramsci. I don't know if you know him, but he was the most influential Italian Communist Party member of that time. He said that Father Brown is a story leading about a small priest, very witty, and he said that the sense of the stories are Father Brown and Catholicism are the good part, and the Protestantism is not the good part. As a communist, he had a good view. Anyway, let me tell you, I'm a Catholic. Anyway, strange, you can understand, strange admirers. The Italian Church and G.K. Chesterton. He was saying he met Pope Pius XI and testified his knowledge of his works. And he said, how much do you write in French? And an important role was played by Pope Paul VI when he was a simple priest. And he was in relationship with that Father Giuseppe De Luca that I mentioned just before. Another important man was man of church was Monsignor Alberto Castelli. He was an archbishop and an Anglicist professor of at Catholic University of Milan. He translated the autobiography and introduced it with a brilliancy. So you can understand that between the clergy, it was very well accepted, and they talked very much about. One man that spoke a lot about G.K. Chesterton was the late Cardinal Giovanni Colombo. He was the Archbishop of Milan. He was the man that introduced to G.K. Chesterton another future cardinal, Cardinal Giacomo Biffi, that said, I think, the most important words about his conversion. He said, G.K. Chesterton was a gift made personally by God to the Catholic Church. Mm-hmm. And he said, he was not raised under a tower bell of a church, he was not raised inside the sacristy or in a strong college or Catholic university. He was at the school of the common sense. You can understand those great men. Another cardinal who is very fond of G.K. Chesterton is the past Archbishop of Bologna, Cardinal Carlo Caffara. He even speaks about him. Anyway, all these things are just very great testimony and witness of the large and the great relationship between Italy and G.K. Chesterton. I was forgetting another great Italian, Pope John Paul I, yeah, who wrote as cardinal a famous letter to G.K. Chesterton. Very witty, very full of love for him. And it was an imaginary letter, because G.K. Chesterton was dead since many decades. And it was part of a book named The Most Illustrious. He put G.K. Chesterton near Dostoevsky, for example. And you can understand how much we loved, and we still love G.K. Chesterton. Anyway, as Nicoletta Neri said, G.K. Chesterton had a great oblivion in Italy, but not only in Italy, because he was a countercultural man. It's so easy. And also inside the Catholic Church, in the next years, 50s, 60s, 70s, and so on, educated people didn't find the right place to put such a tool like G.K. Chesterton, because he was a free man, he was a free Catholic, deep Catholic man. So he was forgotten. Anyway, we have to thank men like the great Aidan Mackey, the most important and gallant rebel I ever met in my life. And we have to thank him if G.K. Chesterton is still here with us today. Anyway, the oblivion was due by another strange religion that takes sort of shape between us. It seems the Catholicism, but it is the bourgeois Christianity. It was not the religion G.K. Chesterton, even if it is so spread and diffused. And their starting of interest towards him is due to to the renewed, the new interest that we have towards Catholicism and traditional Catholicism, and towards the good thing that he learned in his life. Anyway, in Italy, also during the long Chesterton famine, there were two works still published, Orthodoxy and Father Brown Stories. Yes, the Orthodoxy edition is 1927, and is still in print just now. And the Father Brown Stories are always in print. A big business for the publishers. Anyway, you can understand that during this long oblivion, we have some problem. In 1970, I was 5. One night, I was in front of the television with my father, my dear mother, and my dear brother. Perhaps there was also my granny. And we were waiting for the starting of the broadcasting. We had an old black and white television, so we had to wait a long time before the image come out from the video, okay? The one that are older than me can remember. And it was a sort of magic. Great. I was 5 years old, and once I was waiting for the broadcasting of the television. Suddenly, I saw a little priest while a merry song was playing some lyrics whose significance I understood only many years later. It was Father Brown, and the Italian actor Renato Rascel played his role. We had serial broadcasting since December 1770 to February 71. 6 nights. I can't forget them. I was waiting every Tuesday in front of our old black and white TV on my small childish armchair for this tiny priest that I started loving a lot with my dad, my mom, and my brother. I really got in love with this, with those 6 stories. Okay. And when they stopped, they were also a sort of anthology of the best and the most significant quotations of G.K. Chesterton, also from Orthodoxy and other works. When a TV serial ended, I was very sad, but I never forgot that little priest and those wonderful detective stories. I was able to sing the song for the next years. Yeah. And the memory of that hopeful and merry little priest was a company in my life. Then on, when I was 25, and I was a soldier, and that's, it was compulsory to be a soldier for mail and in Italy. Going out of my barracks, I bought a weekly newspaper, and inside it I found a gift book, The Man Who Was Thursday. I didn't know who was the author. Some G.K. Chesterton. But the book thrilled me, and I was very sad when I ended to read it. Once again sad. I strangely suspected that its author shared something with the author of that old TV movie about that tiny priest, the beautiful lyrics, merry song of my childhood. Digging on, I discovered that I found that good old friend, and I went around for bookshops to try to buy some of his books. It was very difficult, as the most part of them was out of print, except the 2 exceptions. Anyway, I started reading him, and I definitely got in love with him. There was no day without a great discovery and without saying, I always wanted to have written it. Or, I always thought this, but I had no words to tell. I think this is the experience of the most of us. And I think it's one of the most beautiful experiences that you can do. It's an humbleness experience. This is great. It was him who taught me the great philosophy of Pimlico. Sorry, I have to check here because I wasn't able to print. And so, if a thing is worth doing, it's worth doing badly. This is our society's motto, my personal motto. Listen, my acceptance of the universe is not optimism, it is more like patriotism. It is a matter of primary loyalty. Primary loyalty. The world is not a lodging house at Brighton, which we are to leave because it is miserable. It is the fortress of our family, with a flag flying on the turret. And the more miserable it is, the less we should leave it. The point is not that this world is too sad to love or too glad not to love. The point is that when you do love a thing, its gladness is a reason for loving it, and its sadness a reason for loving it more. All optimistic thoughts about England and all pessimistic thoughts about her are alike reasons for the English patriot. Similarly, optimism and pessimism are alike arguments for the cosmic patriot. Let us suppose we are confronted with a desperate thing, Saint Pimlico. We think what is really best for Pimlico. We shall find the thread of thought leads to the throne of the mystic and the arbitrary. It is not enough for a man to disapprove of Pimlico. In that case, he will merely cut his throat or move to Chelsea. Nor certainly is it enough for a man to approve of Pimlico. For then it will remain Pimlico, which would be awful. The only way out of it seems to be for somebody to love Pimlico, to love it with a transcendental tie and without any earthly reason granted. If there arose a man who loved Pimlico, then Pimlico would rise into ivory towers and golden pinnacles. Pimlico would attire herself as a woman does when she is loved. For decoration is not given to hide horrible things, but to decorate things already adorable. A mother does not give her children a blue bow because he is so ugly without it. A lover does not give a girl a necklace to hide her neck. Simple. If men love Pimlico as mothers love children, arbitrarily, because it is theirs, Pimlico, in a year or two, might be fairer than Florence. Firenze. Italian word. Some readers would say that this is a mere fantasy. I answer that this is the actual history of mankind, also in Italy. This, as a fact, is how cities did grow great. Go back to the darkest roots of civilization, and you will find them knotted round some circuit stone or encircling some circuit well. People first paid honor to a spot, and afterwards gained glory for it. Man did not love Rome because she was great. She was great because they had loved her.
Yes, hear, hear. Yeah. Yeah.
This is the philosophy of Pimlico, I say. This was one of the most important discoveries of my life. because since then I started talking to my friends about G.K. Chesterton. We started a handful of enthusiasts, the society in 2002, but we never forget also everyday life. First aim of the society was to start again publishing G.K. Chesterton, then to spread his thought. Reading and discussing over it, we discovered the stigmatism and the philosophy of Pimlico, so that I can say together with my wonderful friend Aidan Mackie, we are not a literary society, but merciless propagandists. I'm serious, even if I smile. We discovered that G.K. Chesterton was a joyful and hopeful man, and all that was fitting for us. We feel so near to the Hobbit spirit, so we need to be joyful and hopeful and to eat. And we saw that joy was the gigantic secret of the Christians. Joy and happiness in Christianity were very good for us. Everything was rooted in Chesterton's strong Thomistic realism and gave us a complete vision of life. Chesterton was the joyful recovery of the tradition for some men of my generation, and now also for the younger one, our children. We were looking for tradition, and Chesterton added a new old way to live. A new old way to live, sorry. Sounds good. So we started to rebel against conformism. I go running, but we started many works to rebuild Catholic life around us. We started to live as families living together, not in a material sense, but in sense of solidarity, charity between us. Because we read it from, you know, on Chesterton. He talks always about family. Most beautiful pages, the craziest pages about family. Families living together and helping each other in everyday life. Every family is a reference point and a landmark for the others. Catholic doctrine is at the center of this life, together with sacraments. We started to help you to look at Jesus Christ as the center point of all. We started a new governmental school, named after G.K. Chesterton, as Dale said. We knew other men around the world sharing the same visions as Dale, the late great man, my dear friend Stratford Caldecott, and through him, one other of our heroes, John Cano from Sierra Leone. John Cano is a great man. I have to spend some words about him. We are close friends with John. I can consider him as my brother, as Dale. John has the luck, or the grace, the miracle, to go to study to Oxford with a scholarship. He's a man from Sierra Leone in Africa. He's as old as me, more or less. A married man, father of four. He went there and he met a great man, Stratford Caldecott. And Stratford introduced him to G.K. Chesterton. He was in Oxford for 3 years. Then he could come back or remain there. He had a job in England, because he's a smart man, a genius. And he chose to come back, to go back to Sierra Leone. The harsh civil war was ended in October 2002, he came back home, went back home. Everyone said he was crazy. He went back home because he said, "This is the philosophy of my people. G.K. Chesterton's philosophy is the philosophy of my people. I have to go back there and teach to my fellow citizens how to live, because this is our philosophy. Our true philosophy." not capitalism, not socialism. And he went back in the last 14 years, he built the Sierra Leone Chesterton Center, a group of cooperatives watching at rural life as the center of life, with great faith. And we started helping him 3 years ago. The last January, we sent him a container full of tools for his new, brand new vocational school that is named Chesterton Tools for Development School. And his government gave him a great field to build this school. Now we are helping him, and he is helping us to understand what is the true distributism. It is not talking, but is making such things. And it's great, because we started in the same way with our school. Because we started the school as families, united. And G.K. Chesterton says that the first aim of distributism is to give help to families. And the pivotal player of the distributism is the family, more than property, before property, because the property needs an owner, and the family is the owner, sorry. And there are so many other things to say. Think that we are creating relationships and bonds around us unto the whole world. I'm here not only because Dale graciously invited me, and I am very grateful and very happy to be here, but also because I feel all of you committed to the same eternal revolution. As Saint Catherine of Siena said, if you will be what you should be, you will set on fire all Italy. And I say with G.K. Chesterton, all the world. Distributism wasn't a pastime, a hobby, or a diversion for G.K. Chesterton and the lot. They used it to act like Christians in social and political life, and also in economics. Once, in 2008, I heard Father Ian Boyd in Italy. We were at lunch, and he was speaking about G.K. Chesterton and education. He quoted two or three times G.K. Chesterton. The first was, a dead thing can go with the stream, but only a living thing can go against it. And this became the motto of our school. It was written with fire on my mind, I assure. It is the first quotation of G.K. Chesterton that I went by heart in English. It's quite impossible for me. You see, as you see, I'm sweating like an elephant. Okay. Oh, and the other one. Wait a moment. Sorry, something is not doing. It's working badly. Oh, there is this one. Oh, eccola qui. The coming peril is the intellectual, educational, psychological, and artistic overproduction, which equally with economic overproduction, threatens the well-being of contemporary civilization. People are inundated, blinded, deafened, and mentally paralyzed by a flood of vulgar and tasteless externals, leaving them no time for leisure, thought, our creation from within themselves. I think that this was the starting of a new adventure, the school. And the strange thing is that those quotations were on the website of the Chesterton Academy, and we didn't know. It's a miracle. We decided to establish a school. Oh, it's night. Sorry, I go at the end. Yes, we started. Quite enjoy. Can go. We decided to establish this school to face the world and go on with the Pimlico philosophy. We, a group of 20 families in love with G.K. Chesterton in Italy, the suburb of the empire. Because I know that many English-speaking people ask, why G.K. Chesterton is so popular in Italy? Because he's a great man. Because he says things that no one else can say. So clear, so deep, so wonderful, so witty, so humorous. Che cosa volete? What do you want more? It's so simple. The only problem is to translate, but we can do. We can do many things, sweetheart. So, when we want. So you can see that if you hear some good word, you can change your life. I heard some good word and I changed my life. Jesus changed my life. And your friend's life. Because if you go around Italy and browsing like a beetle and talking about G.K. Chesterton, someone can change his life. Chesterton is effective and has a new life now in Italy. We realized that we were putting in practice what G.K. Chesterton said in G.K. Chesterton's weekly article. Another brief quotation, beautiful, sorry. Be patient for some other minutes. In short, I believe, we have reached the time when the family will be called upon to play the part once played by the monastery. This is to say, there will retire into it not merely the peculiar virtues that are its own, but the crafts and creative habits which once belonged to all sorts of other people. In the old dark ages, it was impossible to persuade the feudal chiefs that it was more worthwhile to grow medicinal herbs in a small garden than to lay waste the province of an empire. That it was better to decorate the corner of a manuscript with gold leaf than to heap up treasuries and wear crowns of gold. These men were men of action. They were hustlers. They were full of vim and pep, snap and zip. Well, eh? In other words, they were diff and blind and partly mad. And rather like, sorry, American millionaires. Simpatico.
Non mi ricordavo.
I couldn't remember. Wonderful. And because they were men of action and men of the moment, all that they did has vanished from the earth like a vapor. And nothing remains out of all that period but the little pictures and the little gardens made by the pottering little monks. As nothing would convince one of the old barbarians that an herbal or a missal could be more important than a triumph in the train of slaves, so nothing could convince one of the new barbarians that a game of hide and seek can be more educative than a tennis tournament at Wimbledon, or a local tradition told by an old nurse more historic than an imperial speech at Wembley. The real national tone will have to remain for a time as a domestic tone. As religion once went into retreat, so patriotism must retire into private life. This does not mean that it will be less powerful. Ultimately, it may be more powerful, just as the monasteries became enormously powerful. Families, enormously powerful thing. But it is by retiring into these forts that we can outlast and wear down the invasion. It is by camping upon these islands that we can await the sinking of the flood. Just as in the Dark Ages, the world without was given up to the vainglory of mere rivalry and violence, so in this passing age, the world will be given up to vulgarity and gregarious fashions and every sort of futility. It is very like the flood, and not least in being unstable as water. Noah had a house, boat, which seems to have contained many other things besides the obvious household pets, and many wild birds of exotic plumage, and many wild beasts of almost fabulous fantasy, many arts counted pagan, and sciences counted rationalistic, may come to roost or burrow in such stormy seasons in the shelter of the convent or of the home. Anyway, we have a great goal to reach and a great thing to do. I wrote this in an article that I wrote for Human Review, and the end is this. I think that this alliance of ideas and people, of tradition and adventure, can lead to great things for the life of the Catholic Church, for the life of families, and for the life of the whole world. Living in this way, with no fear of affirming and exploring our identity, can only be a good thing. Small groups like ours, we consider ourselves a sort of creative minority, to use Pope Benedict's term, can indeed change the world, as the monastic movement originally did. This is a solid road for any fellowship to set out on. And there is also a link between a true monastic movement, that is the monks of Norcia, for example. I don't know if you know them. There are the most truly Chestertonian monks that I know all over the world, because they brew. They appreciate G.K. Chesterton. Half of them are Americans. And we are in close relationship because of this. Because we are trying to do what G.K. Chesterton said in those lines, okay? And this is starting to be a hope for many, many, many people. There are someone that is asking us to help from America, from other places of the world, and this is very strange, because we are really a tiny thing. But I assure you that we are completely grateful to G.K. Chesterton for all of this. You can understand that I'm forced to be short and I have to cut, but anyway, you can understand that the legacy of G.K. Chesterton for Italy is so great. We are so grateful to him, and we consider him truly a man of Christian virtues, as you can understand. We consider him a saint. Thank you. Okay.
Appreciation in G.K. Chesterton and his work. We call it the Outline of Sanity Award.
My My case is sanity.
Yeah, matto.
Bravo. Sì, sì.
But in spite of that, this year we're going to give the ACS Outline of Sanity Award to Marco Cervini. Prove that you were here.
She will prove it. Yeah. Yes, she will say it's too late. Yeah. Where ought I, am I to be? Oh.
We have time for just one or two questions for Marco, if anybody wants to ask a question. Marco, go ahead. Leo.
Do you still remember that theme song, and can you give us a bar?
Yes. Am I to sing it? Yeah. I can perform, but I have also here inside. I need the help of the music. Wait a moment. Wait. I'm always ready.
Pronti, sempre.
Sempre pronto, eccolo qui. Aspetta. Padre Brown. Padre Brown, it means Father Brown, eh?
E sono un prete celibe.
That means not married. A priest not married.
Sal crimine.
Only for save the soul. Of a poor teen. He's interested to cry only for this. Understand? The real crime is pessimism. Who doesn't believe in life? You can vote for trust.
Come si dice di grazia?
Va bene, si va.
If you want, I can go on.
I can't applaud you. You can see I'm completely mad. So.
One more question, Marcus.
Yes. Dorothy Sayers did a wonderful translation of Dante into English. She writes about the difficulty of translating the different dialects of Dante's Italian into English. Yes. And I just can't imagine the difficulty of translating Chesterton's beautiful use of language into Italian. Talk about the difficulty of that.
You can imagine the amount of notes at the end of the pages. Inches and inches of notes to explain what he was saying, because there are so many jokes and games and strange things. This is a thing that you don't have. This is Radio Chesterton. Radio Chesterton, if you want. These are the collection of half of the
radio broadcasts.
Radio broadcasting on BBC. Translated in Italian. You don't have, not in Italian. You have, but you have scattered on the web, strange things.
What he's trying to say, is that they published a book of Chesterton's radio broadcasts before we did. That's what he's trying to say.
Bravo.
But to Marcus's point, the Dorothy L. Sayers translation, the whole strength of that is the footnotes. I mean, you have to read the footnotes in order to really get what's going on. And he's saying that's the same, you have the same problem with all of Chester's idioms and the witticisms. They have to be explained. And yet, you know, that you still get Dante through that translation of Dorothy L. Sayers. And obviously, somehow Chesterton comes through in the translation. It is really a miracle. It really is. That's why Chester is a universal writer. Yeah. Okay, everyone, we will gather again tomorrow morning. We're going to start a little early. We're going to start at 5 a.m. tomorrow. We want to stay on track. No, there is a mass tomorrow morning. And where can someone tell anyone where the chapel is here on campus? Does anyone know that? Here's John Hicks, the guy who drove the shortest distance. He lives in Slippery Rock.
The easiest way to find it is if you see the big clock tower, which is their old main building. It's right across the street, up the hill from that. It's right across the street. It's called the Rock Catholic Parish Center. It was their old Newman Center.
Number eight on the map.
That's right.
And what time is the mass?
7:30.
Two different maps with two different numbers, so keep that in mind.
Yes.
Either parking permit, no parking permit, two different maps, two different numbers. It's a paradox. All right. And then we start here at 9 a.m. And please remember to wear your name tags, okay? Please remember to wear your name tags. There's three reasons. One is so that everyone can get to know your name, and especially me. And also, we know that you actually should be here. We don't have to throw you out. or collect more money than you want to pay. And the third reason, well, I'm sure there is one. Okay, so God bless and good night. Thank you.